Clearly.
Aye.
Yes.
What is your occupation, Mr. Clerk?
I am the president of Evergreen Environmental Energy Consulting Firm with an office in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania.
What is your occupation, Mr. Clerk?
I have BA from Ohio University. I attended graduate school of public and international affairs, including coursework in their master's program for public administration.
Could you describe your professional experience following your graduate school?
Immediately following, I accepted a position in the Shatt Administration and Governor's Office as a planner in the Office of State Planning and Development in developing a statewide land use plan for his administration. 2 years later, I was selected to be executive director of the Citizens Advisory Council of the then Department of Environmental Resources, EPR. I was established as effectively a citizen ombudsman with a council of 12 people appointed by the governor, president pro tem, and speaker, whose job it was to oversee EPR's program, evaluate their effectiveness, review all draft regulations, review all proposed pieces of legislation, and report to the governor and the General Assembly as to whether EPR is effectively doing their job and implementing the programs in the manner in which the legislature had asked. I had that position for 8 years, left for almost 2 years to start a consulting firm called ERC Consulting in Energy and the Environment. And in November of 1986, the then newly elected governor, Robert Casey, requested that I come back to state government and appointed me deputy secretary for environmental protection within the then Department of Environmental Resources. My responsibilities there were to handle all regulatory programs in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania on a day-to-day basis, including all delegated federal programs. That included the air program, the water quality program, all the waste programs, municipal, residual, hazardous waste, radioactive waste, radiation protection, including the nuclear power plants, all drinking water programs as well, the hazardous sites cleanup program, Penn Vest infrastructure program, oil and gas program, the deep mine safety program, the surface mining program, all laboratories, and the responsibility for the day-to-day supervision of 2,100 people in 6 regional offices, 19 sub-regional offices, and the central office.
Did you have a specific role with respect to the adoption and implementation of the current Pennsylvania environmental regulations?
Both as my time at the Citizens Advisory Council and as deputy, I had direct involvement in perhaps the passage of at least 15 environmental statutes, some of which I was the principal author. In my 4 years as deputy, I approved all environmental regulatory regulations that were submitted to the Environmental Quality Board for adoption.
What was your career after you left state government?
After I left state government, I left after 4 years to take a position as vice president of EMAS, a solid waste company in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, that owned or operated landfills and recycling facilities in approximately 6 states. We sold that company 2 years later, and I began my career as a consultant, and with a partner, created Evergreen Environmental, and I have been an environmental consultant to both public and private entities in environmental and energy projects for the last 22 years.
And handing you what's been marked as LEC Exhibit 22, is that your current resume or state department?
It is.
Have you ever been qualified to testify as an expert witness in proceeding like this?
I have, yes.
Could you describe those?
I've been a witness, an expert witness, before the Environmental Hearing Board in Pennsylvania. That is the body that hears all of the appeals of BP actions and EPR actions. I've been an expert in the regulatory process in Pennsylvania and the statutory and regulatory requirements of all environmental programs, including delegated federal policies and procedures and practices of DEP and DEOR.
Are you familiar with the design of the Lackawanna Energy Center facility as it is currently proposed?
I am.
I'd like to read you a portion of the Jessup Rural Zoning Ordinance. I'm going to answer a few questions. This is from Section 1.300, Community Development Objectives. The adoption and enforcement of these regulations is intended to provide the municipality with procedures which will assist in directing its growth and development in accordance with local needs and goals. More specifically, it is intended to create a pattern of land uses which is compatible and harmonious, where a suitable environment may be created for residential, commercial, and industrial functions. The protection of our present and future residential areas is a prime concern, as well as the reservation and protection of lands which are considered desirable. desirable and suitable for commercial and industrial uses, but not those industrial uses which will emit nuisances which would have an adverse effect on any part of the community. So with that statement of legislative intent from the borough council, the question to the board is whether this proposed power plant or any modern natural gas plant power plant can in fact be built and operated in Jessup Borough if, in the words of the zoning ordinance, it will emit nuisances which would have an adverse effect on any part of the community.
Absolutely not. It would be an abuse of discretion for the Department of Environmental Protection and sister agencies who are reviewing all aspects of this plant to allow the plant to produce any uses as defined in the ordinance, which is backed up by the same language in the legislation. But I can also say that my knowledge of the design of this plant also relates to my experience in the last 22 years with all types of energy facilities. I have worked and provided consulting services, permitting, etc., on coal-fired power plants, on wind projects in Pennsylvania, on ethanol projects, on a wood-fired power plant, on a waste-to-energy facility, did all the permitting, on three natural gas power plants, both baseline and major solar projects in Pennsylvania, as well as biomass. So my understanding of this plant and the relationship of the regulatory requirements which will be imposed and will buttress the concerns that you have relative to your zoning ordinances demand that this be done in a way that protects public health, safety, and the environment is because of my knowledge of those regulations.
How many permits does a facility like this have to obtain from the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection?
In this specific case, it will be at least approximately, I'll say, 9 environmental approvals or permits required for this facility, in which there will be at least 7 agencies, federal and state, who are currently in some manner reviewing or have the lead responsibility for issuing the approvals or the permits, and the others have review functions, such as EPA and others. There are probably 11 or 12 environmental statutes in Pennsylvania, which Invenergy must comply with, and about 22 to 23 chapters of the regulations have some element that will address some aspect of this plan. I can tell the council that there is not an aspect of the construction or the operation of this facility which will not be subject to rigorous performance and prescriptive requirements either from the department or sister agencies which will discuss.
I'd like to go through some of the permits for this facility or some changes.
The permits that are required from DEP have nothing to do with whether this zoning ordinance is invalid under the Pennsylvania municipal law. They have to do with an entirely separate regulatory scheme. And while it is very reassuring that this testimony has been presented, that DEP will do its duty and impose all of the regulatory enforcement that is necessary, that has nothing to do and is irrelevant with respect to this proceeding. Section 5 of Section 908 of the Municipalities Planning Code excludes irrelevant testimony, and as interesting as this testimony is, it is irrelevant.
I would have to let me fundamentally disagree.
Well, Mr. Wild, that's my job.
Thank you.
Although we said it earlier. First of all, Mr. McClellan specifically associated what he's going to testify about with respect to the requirements for protection of health, safety, and welfare that are in the Jessup Borough ordinance. Second, at a more personal level, I'm rather amazed that given what Mr. Miles and his clients have been saying in his community, that he has actually objected to evidence regarding public health, safety, and welfare. I'm amazed.
Oh my gosh.
Not to zoning. Or any facility like it will be protected with public health safety.
Not to zoning.
Well, then you get off your soapbox now. The objection here is a legal objection to the purpose of this hearing, which is to determine whether this ordinance is invalid or not on the grounds that were raised by the applicant. This hearing has
nothing to do with whether the Jessup zoning ordinance, in fact, or this application, in fact, complies with the general language at the beginning of the ordinance that the township wishes to protect its environment. The environment has nothing to do with this hearing.
So,
come on, our solicitor.
Mr. Morelli made very clear what the purpose of the 2,000-foot setback in this ordinance is. It is to protect public health, safety, and welfare.
But this place is supposed to be safe.
It's a relevant issue, particularly in the context of a self-described environmental lawyer suggesting that we should reduce a 2,000-foot setback to 500 feet.
Well, Attorney Miles, what would be the harm?
Because it's propaganda.
The public doesn't want to hear the information as to the health and safety of it. Are you telling me the objectors don't want to hear this information?
Yes.
We know this information.
This hearing is not about the environment. And as much as the attorney for Invenergy wants to make this personal, I'm not going to do that. This has nothing to do with
starting this hearing.
I'm speaking, sir. This has nothing to do with starting this hearing.
Gentlemen.
This has nothing to do with us and stop making it about us.
Gentlemen, that's enough. Let me get back to my original question, Attorney Miles. Please answer for me. What is ultimately the harm, other than maybe keeping us off here a few extra minutes tonight? What's the harm in hearing this matter?
The harm is that the municipality's planning code, which governs these proceedings, excludes irrelevant testimony. There has been no development and no submission by the applicant here as to how the DEP regulations have anything whatsoever to do with whether this township, whether this borough ordinance is invalid or not.
If the argument is that this particular use belongs in the M2 zone, given that we are or no, I feel that this evidence should be heard. I feel this is relevant to the
course you are.
Council definitely wants to hear as much evidence.
Well, then seek out. Then why don't they plead for it and seek their outside counsel?
So, let your objection be noted and continue.
Oh, thank God. What a crook.
We're here to learn.
Get your gun in 2 years.
Where were you 3 years ago?
The experts
teach you. That's wrong. What a crook. I think it should be thrown out.
Let's try again, Mr. McClellan. Let's go through the permits that this proposed facility, or any facility like it, will have to obtain from the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection. Let's start with air quality plan approval.
Objection irrelevant. I don't know what the entire line of questioning is. If this is an offer of proof, I'll consider it.
What's the objection? The question is based
on. I'm being asked to make a continuing objection to questions I haven't heard.
I'll just keep going.
Air quality plan approval.
Yes, this is probably the principal environmental permit that they must seek and have applied for to the Department of Environmental Protection, which was reviewed by EPA. This is the permit that allows the construction of the air source. This is the permit that will establish what is the best available control technology for this plant, what are the emission rates that the air pollution control equipment, APC equipment, will see, has to achieve, and what are the limits on each pollutant concern that will come from this facility, including greenhouse gases limitations that this plant under new requirements. They cannot touch or even begin construction of the air source until this permit, which is pending, is issued by the department. And and that includes air model analysis, which will show dispersion models of where any emissions, how far, and what kind would go.
Next one, air quality operator.
Objection. An important
Your continuing objection is noted.
An important point as it relates to the group say what they want. And many of the requirements relative to nuisances. Good. This facility cannot just get an authorization to put a product, build the air pollution control, air pollution control equipment, and begin operating.
Can you hold this?
They must, after they construct it, within 180 days, submit an operating permit application to the department with detailed modeling of the maximum output of the plant to prove that the air pollution control equipment that was installed is meeting the emission rates, and they are meeting the emission limits which they committed to you and the Department of Environmental Protection. If they aren't doing that, DEP would deny an operating permit.
Next one, NPDES stormwater construction program.
There's a national pollutant discharge elimination system permit required by the Federal Water Pollution Control Act. It is delegated to DEP. Our Clean Streams Law in Pennsylvania requires its own permit. And what this says is, during the construction of the facility, all stormwater must be managed on site so it doesn't disturb the off-site stream, grassy creek, or if you don't have any accelerated erosion or sedimentation to harm the waters of the Commonwealth, including groundwater. They cannot do any of the disturbance on the site as that's defined until this permit has been issued. And this permit is also, by the way, being reviewed by your Lackawanna on the county conservation.
This is the permit limited to power plants?
It is not. It's a common permit that even a development housing development is required to do. Anybody that's basically over an acre and they're disturbing the earth is required to show that they're controlling stormwater and they're also controlling erosion and sedimentation.
Next one, NPDES industrial discharge permit, part one.
There's been concerns raised regarding the impact on the grassy island creek and any discharges due to the operation of this facility. This facility is required to get an industrial discharge permit for the processed water, which will be discharged through an outlet into the grassy creek. This permit will establish water quality criteria to protect the uses of grassy island creek and numerical limits which they cannot exceed, and will require daily and consistent monitoring reports which are publicly available to prove they're having no impact on the existing conditions or the existing uses of that stream and the Lackawanna River, which is frozen.
So, what's called confirmation compliance?
It is. It's record keeping and reporting to be on a regular basis, much of it electronic, and most all of it available to the public and the borough council.
Excellent. Water obstruction and encroachment permit.
Yes, this is both a federal and a state program. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is reviewing this jointly. Anytime you're going to obstruct, getting close to, put a bridge across, put a wharf in, anything that affects a stream or a wetland, you're encroaching on it or you're creating an obstruction. You have to prove that you're not harming it, or if you are, you're repairing it and reproducing all the key functions and values. There are three wetlands on site. The likelihood that no wetlands will be impacted. There's a potential for 2/10 of an acre to be impacted, which they would have to
respond. Excellent. Water quality management permit, part two. Objection to
The department not only requires water quality limits, the effluent discharge from this plant, they also then require approval of what kind of treatment facility and what kind of outlet are you building on grassy island creek. This is a part two permit, which they will not apply to until DEP says these are the water quality limits that you must meet for the discharge of the grassy island creek. Then they will submit a permit saying, okay, here's the design of the treatment and as well as the outfall. And that has to be approved as well. Permits, by the way, in draft form, in the Pennsylvania Golden, and we provided a few for your review prior to